So good morning.
Good morning.
So we're back from Belize. Mm-hmm. It's not quite as, the beach isn't quite there. So let's talk about technology and the human condition for a little while, because this is a topic that's really going to change how everybody understands their life, their walking around space, how they go grocery shopping, how they experience themselves. There's even an aspect of this that we'll talk about maybe over the next couple of weeks in terms of what humanity is about to become, how it's going to engage with itself.
I listened to this report on NPR a couple of days ago. There's a scientist in Stanford whose specialty is virtual reality. And the reporter, and he went to an arcade, a VR arcade, and they were playing games, but he refused to play a game where he had to kill someone with a gun. Even though it was a button or a handheld thing, he refused to do that. And the reason why is because he's so convinced from his studies that whether it's real or not real, the body reacts the same. And so by shooting the gun in virtual reality, the body's muscles begin to be trained and the mind begins to be trained to make it okay to shoot this gun.
Yeah, the muscle memory begins to be structured in such a way that if X, then Y. There's no thinking, there's no emotion, there's no rationale. It's in that case. Understand right from the beginning of this that the defense industry, DARPA in the military, this is how they're now training soldiers.
Yeah.
And so it becomes a very robotic type of person doing a task.
And on the other hand, he was saying that it's very much used for good because it can reprogram a person's whole life if they're in post-traumatic stress syndrome,
sure,
or they have some kind of other issue up. It's a way to reprogram in a positive sense.
Sure.
So that they get over that stuck place.
So, but the key word here is programming.
Yeah.
And it's not you who's doing the programming. It's an external experience that's doing
it. It's not the individual.
That's right. It's not the individual. The individual is not going out on the tennis court to train muscle memory to play a game that it wants to play.
Mm-hmm.
So let's define virtual reality in the context. So even in that same news interview, the reporter said she had never played virtual reality at all. And so she puts the headset on and she is immediately at a platform in a building that is above the clouds, looking down at the clouds in real time in her brain's perception.
Way down.
And then
below.
The message was step out on the platform, which is only, you know, a 2 feet by 2 feet type of thing, and look down. And she couldn't do it. The reason she couldn't do it is she wasn't saying to herself, it's only a game, but I can't do it. The brain didn't know. Now, we've been saying for years in classes that if you go to the movies and you're sitting in the movies and all of a sudden the bad guy jumps out from the bushes, or if you're walking outside the movie and the bad guy jumps out from the bushes, the brain doesn't know the difference.
Mm-hmm.
And so the processing unit doesn't understand whether it's real or whether it's Memorex, as we used to say a long time ago. So this virtual reality is just one form of technology that's very fascinating in itself. But to your point, there's a lot of great opportunities in mental health, in post-traumatic stress syndrome, in understanding what happens when you step into an experience. They were using the example of when you watch your hand stick out, it's a different color,
right?
Skin color. And all of a sudden the brain believes you are black, brown, blue, orange, red, green,
right?
Because you're seeing it. This is who I am.
And they put the person with a different colored arm into situations where they get to experience racism or bigotry.
Right, and internally the body understands racism.
Yeah.
And so that's just an example. But the brain perceives its experience as a real experience.
Now, I don't want to sound like an old fart here, but there's a part of me that says, whoa, let's slow down on this. It's kind of like years and years ago when the television first came out and the parents said, oh no, this is a bad thing for the kids. Which it did change culture.
Oh, absolutely changed culture.
And so the iPhone virtual reality is changing culture, but there's a part of me that wants to just say, slow down, let's research the good side of the stick and the bad side of the stick.
Well, let's take it from virtual reality into additional technologies. And in real terms, your smartphone. And what's happened, smartphone is 10 years old. It's brand new.
12 years old or so.
10, 12 years old, brand new. Mm-hmm. And the level of addiction from the standpoint of looking at it, having to have it, having to keep going back to it, the addictiveness of it. There's an aspect where engineers used to build things in order to have them work for you. Now engineers are trained to how to build programs to persuade you.
Right.
And that's a huge difference because it's not the machine that is now usable to the client. It is now the machine that tells the brain you need to eat cereal because it's really good for you. And you go, okay, now advertising has been a subliminal and not so subliminal thing forever. But basically it is programming, it's mm-hmm. mind conditioning. Now the sophistication of the technology is such that it does that. But when we start talking about addiction, we could go in that track also here. The addictiveness to kids is enormous. They are on that cell phone or that technology 11 to 13 hours a day, according to the great new studies. So what happens is, you know, where's the socialization? I mean, how many times we started having this conversation years ago when we went to dinner and we watched six kids sitting at a table texting one another, not talking. Mm-hmm. And it was like completely programmed out.
Well, and it's unconscious. It's not only unconscious, the culture now promotes it and supports it. And so a kid who doesn't have a cell phone is ostracized.
Right, right. So you're watching a humanity being moved, not chosen, but being directed. So we're not taking a corporations here, by these large corporate structures that are invested in a result for themselves.
Greed.
And so where this really goes is there's going to be a backlash or a response, because this level is very much just like the opioid conditioning. It creates a public health issue. Mm-hmm. And so when you have the mind being programmed, virtual realities, or whether it's the what's on the iPhone and what you keep going back to.
And advertising.
That's a programming. That's a conditioning of the mind. And so the whole nature of society is being conditioned in certain ways. So you're getting less and less engagement. There is a flip side, you know, and you hear the backlashes where a whole handful of the young kids are simply saying, this doesn't work. I don't have any sense of who you are. I don't know how to talk to you. Mm-hmm. So there's all kinds of pluses and minuses and push and shoves in this. But the place where I want to go with this, and maybe we can do this over the next couple of weeks, is there is a monumental shift taking place in terms of the human condition. Due to technology, mm-hmm. due to different constructs, due to greeds at completely a different level than ever before, due to the subliminal and subtle ways of moving, there is a human condition that's being altered. And if I take this out to a point where we play in Mastering Alchemy, we play from a spiritual side, this whole artificial intelligence, robotics, the nature of technology, is going to lead to a certain direction. From an internal spiritual standpoint, as you start to begin to approach the soul where we're playing, the thinking that we call artificial intelligence, the processing of information at these levels, is how the soul thinks, not as a machine, as a means of perceiving a reality at that level of computation and perception is how the soul thinks. So
you're saying that the soul thinks like the technology does now, from a bigger umbrella?
Oh, place? Much, and even much bigger than the technology. Technology right now is really in a very infancy stage. Mm-hmm. So the purpose of the kind of this conversation is pay attention to this.
How do you choose?
How do you choose? But see, here, in a way, how do you choose is being chosen for you on a on-the-ground human walking around economy.
See, that's why it's so important for people to be able to discern and not just click on the button because it's there, because it's a bright red or the ad
right.
looks attractive. It's hard
right.
to
right.
pull away from that programming.
Exactly. And especially when it tastes good, it feels good,
right.
it's kind of okay, so who cares? All of a sudden, just like so many other things, you wind up way over here,
right.
we'll use an addiction. It was only this, it really didn't make that big of a deal. And well, can you back out of it?
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of it. So let's do this, let's kind of use this conversation as a setup,
yes.
and let's have this again next week.
Good.
So we'll see you next week. Thank you.